Hi, everybody.
Hi, this is Trey Parker.
This is Matt Stone. This is the season 12 DVD commentary that we have been so excited about for weeks. We've been just aching to do this. We just got done doing the season, a week and a half ago?
Yep. And we basically spend the years making a season just so that we can do commentary.
Yeah, we love it.
We just think about it all year long about what we're going to say in the commentary.
It was hard. It's just after Thanksgiving as we record this, and I was calling Trey all Thanksgiving. I was like, can you believe it? Next Monday, we get to do commentary.
Commentary.
Oh my God, I'm so fucking
excited. No more sitting around on the couch watching football. We're going to go down to the office and do commentary.
And talk about the shit that we just did. So anyway, with that, let's get going on tonsil trouble.
We actually just finished. We're starting to catch up to our seasons now because we just finished season 12, a week ago?
Yeah,
a week and a half ago. We did the last episode, the vampire episode. And so that means that this, which was the first, was back in March or something like that.
Yeah, it must have been, yeah.
And in very typical fashion, what happened with this episode was we made this ahead of time, meaning a few weeks ahead of, before the run, thinking, all right, we'll make a show that we can sort of bank and show later in the run so that we can get a few days off.
This will for sure be funny and easy to do.
Yeah. And so we
Cartman getting AIDS.
We animated about half of it, and then of course, as always, it got to be Saturday before the first show was supposed to air, and we just didn't know what to do, and so we just
We did. We bailed on the Britney show.
We bailed on two shows. It was going to be the strike show. We had
right.
the strike show going, and we had Britney going.
Basically, what happens is we always have a really good idea for the first show that we think, and we have a lot of faith in it, and then as it gets close to the air date, we freak out and basically lose faith in whatever show we're doing and push it and then grab some other idea and we end up screwing it up.
Yeah. And just go with the simplest thing we have.
So we were going to start this episode. I mean, this run, I remember we were going to start with the Britney show.
Right.
And then we decided, no, that's too hardcore. We need to start with the strike show.
Which is so funny because it just doesn't matter what show we start with anymore.
No one even fucking cares, except for us.
Most people see it on the internet or DVDs anyway. So it's it totally doesn't matter what show's first, but we freak out about it anyway.
It's very 1980s and 70s of us to think that people actually are sitting around. Yeah. Going, wow, what's going to be the first episode? Because there's no other way to see it,
Right.
Back then, but now there is.
And we realized, with this, the hard thing was that as people were watching it, even as some of the writers that we were showing it to, because we had kind of done it ahead of time, everyone's kind of sitting there going, okay, well, Cartman obviously doesn't really have AIDS, so what's going on here? And so as you're watching this, you're kind of going, okay, so what's the joke? What's the joke? And it's like, no, he really does have AIDS.
Yeah, that was the big struggle, was making sure people knew that, no, he really does. He really does have AIDS. I think the big breakthrough, too, is finally coming up with we didn't really have an end, and then we came up with the cash thing.
Yeah, that was our big breakthrough.
That was our big breakthrough that got us to this episode. Once we came up with the cash thing, we're like, oh, this could be a first episode.
Well, what
America's hanging by a thread wondering what we're going to do for our first episode.
I mean, I do love, the thing that I love, the reason that, we had a lot of faith in this one was just because I think that some of the dialogue between Cartman and Kyle in this is some of their best dialogue. There's just scenes of them just, sitting there talking to each other that are some of the funniest, I think, that they've ever.
When he gives Kyle AIDS, that's a good moment. I thought it was funny. HIV positive.
And it's great, too, that as soon as he gets AIDS, he suddenly starts dressing like Tom Hanks in Philadelphia. He even wears a little Philadelphia hat.
Yeah, I forgot about that. That's
and a scarf, because that's what people do when they get a terminal disease, is they start wearing a scarf.
A little cough and a scarf. All right, let's move on to... That's pretty good, right?
Did we
do enough for this?
That was good. That was really good.
Good start.
Live from Chicago. So this is the Britney show, which is among the top... in the top five of what we call polarizing episodes, because this is one of those shows where it's basically people totally loved it and it's one of their favorite shows, or people just totally hated it, which was interesting because when we put it out,
kind of like Britney Spears actually,
exactly,
mirroring Britney Spears' popularity, which was our point.
It's just one of those shows where you're either on the train, or if you're not on the train, then it's a big bummer the whole time, because it's just you're either kind of in on the joke or it's just really stupid. And our first feedback, and we've learned not to pay much attention to it, but all the message boards, which is usually just all the kids, they didn't get it at all. But then we started hearing back from friends, and it's weird, the more we traveled north. A lot of people in Canada really liked it, and a lot of people in New York really liked it. But a lot of our friends who, especially if you know the lottery, and we know that's not like real pop culture reference, but you know, the big idea of doing the lottery with Britney Spears, we thought was a pretty cool idea. But we get that if you don't really get that, then
they'll just be like, why are you being so mean?
But you still get peeing on a ladybug.
We never thought that the episode was mean to Britney Spears. We thought it was mean to the press.
And
there are people
us.
Who thought, yeah, mean to ourselves. And people really thought it was like, it was mean to, people who thought, oh my God, they're doing that to Britney Spears.
Just didn't get it
and misunderstood it. But there is also like, even if you do get it, this episode is definitely, there are some points this episode there were laughs. We definitely like, it's less about laughs and more about, no, this is the point.
Right.
You know, and especially at the end where it's like, nope, it's not funny.
Right.
Fuck you. You just have to kind of sit here and watch it.
We're not putting the jokes in and the stoning, you know. And it's like,
just kind of have to sit there and suck it.
Yeah. Because that was, you know, we were talking about, I remember being on the writer's retreat for this run and we're talking about things to do and, you know, it was during that week, you know, I mean, there are a lot of weeks where Britney was self-destructing, but it was right during that time where it was just the very worst. And it was really during that week where everyone was like, she's going to kill herself. She's going to kill herself for sure. And so we're like, all right, well, let's have her kill herself on the show.
Right.
And that was really the thing, is like, think how timely people will think we are, because we were just guessing she was going to kill herself. And we'd have the show kind of ready to go. And,
yeah.
But she did. She pulled through. So.
Oh, yeah, she pulled through. That's good. It was a little bit like, I mean, we're obviously the most, like, ready to make fun of celebrities and their stupid obsessions. But it was kind of unnerving that time, especially, like, you'd go out to dinner with, like, really mild-mannered people. And like, I can't wait to see her just kill herself. How's she going to kill herself? You're like, really, man? Yeah. Like, really want someone to kill herself?
And that's kind of why we had Kyle, you know, Kyle in the show. And that was the thing. Some people, too, were like, oh,
like, we're usually
are,
those guys, like, but not like my, like, mom,
yeah,
and
but
stuff.
They're like, you guys are hypocrites because you're the ones that do this to celebrities. And we're like, yeah, we know. And that's why Kyle says that. Like, we're all responsible for this. And maybe this one time, you know, it's got to be all okay. But maybe this one time we should kind of let her alone, you know, because she is going to fucking kill herself. And she didn't kill herself. I think it's thanks to us, actually. She probably didn't kill herself.
Yeah, she didn't kill herself. But the other, you know, the other thing was this point right here where she actually shoots her head off.
Yeah.
That was the really kind of tricky part.
Yeah, it was basically from that moment of the show, you're either on the train or you're not on the train.
that was the real tricky part.
Yeah. If you're not on the train, then we're not. It's not stopping for you. All right, let's move on.
Let's move on. It was just a joke. My kids
ain't here. So this is Major Boobage, which is a pretty fun episode. It was pretty brutal for basically the whole idea of trying to do something in heavy metal. You know, and we had the idea on the retreat, let's do something, you know, heavy metal, and then we came up with the whole thing with the cats and the drugs and all that. And, you know, we knew we had a good idea, but when we came back, it was one of those ideas, we came back and told production and they're just staring at us, you know, blankly, like, okay, well, we need a year to do that because we're suddenly taking, you know, our little construction paper cutouts and we're saying, okay, now take our entire engine and make it look like heavy metal, which is all, you know, cell drawings. And really,
well, we've done a lot of animation styles before, like anime and even the World of Warcraft stuff we did with our machines. But so we kind of wrongly thought that we could figure out a computerized shortcut.
Yeah.
Basically to do that Ralph Bakshi rotoscoping look. And so we kind of didn't plan, but basically in the end we basically had to hand draw.
Me and Matt had to sit and hand draw everything. No.
We got a bunch of coffee and stayed up for 5 weeks.
We tried. We R&D'd it a long time and tried to get, you know, the computers to get that look, and it just, you know, you can't get that look. And so we're finally like, okay, well, it's all going to have to be hand-drawn. And they're like, okay, well, we need a year. And we're like, okay, well, we won't do it first then. We'll do it like, you know, we'll have 3 weeks. We'll do it. And basically we did sort of the same thing we did for Warcraft, where we hired another bunch of animators.
Real artists who could really draw.
And, you know, everyone in our building, a lot of people in our building are totally capable of doing, and did a lot of it too. But we just needed the extra help. And, you know, the storyboard department, who are all... our storyboard department are all great artists, and so they were able to make all the drawings, but then you just had to hire all these people to do all these in-betweens that just took...
Basically the equivalent, like, we had to set up a mini Korea in our, like, just the...
And we got
done.
To see for a few weeks what it's like to do a real animated show.
Yeah, it's terrible.
It's horrible.
By the way, if we had to do an animated show that way, we would never fucking have done it.
No.
Yeah, we wouldn't have even finished like two shows.
No. We'd be halfway through season one right now.
It's ridiculous how slow. I mean, our animation process we think is slow and like watching paint dry, and this is nothing compared to hand-drawn cell animation.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous. Why people do that?
And really, the worst part about making this episode was we had to watch heavy metal like three times. Because, you know, people are like, that's cool, you did heavy metal, you're heavy metal fans. It's like, no, I think it sucks. I thought it sucked when I was 10 or whatever when it came out. I think it sucks now. And it was just, you know, I mean, I guess I get it that it was what it was, but it's just a crappy movie.
I think I had better recollections of it.
Yeah,
it's one of those things like, oh yeah, that was awesome. Because yeah, you've been told it's awesome.
Like, really?
You watch it, go, shit. I mean, there's like two little good shots in it. There's a bunch of crap in it.
Yeah.
But yeah, we did have to watch it like three times.
There's way more plot that makes sense in this 1 minute right here than there is in the entire real heavy metal movie.
The big breakthrough with this too, we're in the writer's meeting, is when we finally hit on the thing of like, oh yeah, all those is making it major boobage and making it about boobs, and there's boobs on the buildings, and it's just like basically all that kind of like heavy metal art.
Just random violence like that.
Yeah, it's also, but no, it's reason. Also just geeks like wanting to draw boobs, basically.
Yeah.
You know, and have it not
boobs everywhere.
Yeah.
But again, it's all the, you know, it's great. All these backgrounds and everything. It really shows off what our, you know, what our storyboard department and artists can actually do in this building.
Yeah, they designed all these characters.
Don't have to do little circles and squares all the time.
All right, that's pretty good, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Let's move on.
So this is Canada on Strike, which a lot of people think was a parody of the writer's strike that was happening right at the time, but it's actually not. It's a docudrama of exactly what happened with the writer's strike. It is completely what happened. I remember the season before that, the end of season 11, and we couldn't come up with an idea for an episode. And that was right when the strike happened. And we're like, really? There's a strike? We can go on strike? And we were so excited because we were going to get out without having to make the last show, which we didn't have an idea for, and we were stressing out. And then Anne, the producer, said, no, we're not union. And I was like, well, that doesn't matter. We have to strike in solidarity with our brothers and sisters.
We're going
to
strike in solidarity.
And so we really were trying to strike really hard. And then finally, no, you guys have to work. And we're like, damn it. And we had to sit and come up with a show.
People kept emailing me, are you guys going to go on strike? And I was like, God, I wish we could.
Yeah.
Then we wouldn't have to work.
And some of our writers did go on strike.
One of our writers tried. She voted for the strike. What they did is they got all the writers and they went down to the convention center when they voted for the strike. Remember? And they got, basically it was like this, hey, everyone, get together, we're going to vote for the strike. So like 20,000 or 10,000 writers went down to the convention center. Everyone, most of them drunk because they got at the dinner before. They're going to go out to dinner after.
Right.
And they got them all riled up and they all vote. Like 90% of them voted for the strike. And honestly, because we, you know, obviously unscientifically, but every single writer I talked to within 3 weeks was like, I wish I hadn't voted for the strike. They were all so instantly bummed.
They absolutely, so completely they got, fucked themselves.
They got totally snowed. And then they all didn't go to work for 6 months.
And we didn't
months.
Feel, you know, it's like they got duped. And that's why we wanted to make this show, because they really did have these idiot WGA leaders who were basically like, you know, within a couple weeks, they realized they had just fucked everyone super hard. And they're like, all right, how do we get out of this without looking like the biggest douches in the world? And so then they basically do exactly what they do at the end of the show, which is they get nothing, but then they try to convince everyone that they got everything. And they
remember
literally,
they said this is the biggest labor victory in the 21st century or 22nd
at all. They got nothing, and then they said that they had a celebration party. They actually had a celebration party, and friends of ours that went said that they were literally writers standing around with martini glasses trying to smile, just knowing they had all gotten super fucked out a bunch of money and didn't get anything in return.
DGA didn't strike and got all the same stuff.
Yeah.
It was so lame.
And so, but meanwhile, you know,
it was just watching, basically, and that's what, you know, we have this bad guy in this episode who basically dupes the country of Canada. Because if someone comes along and says, hey, you're getting screwed, you know, and you don't know any better, you're like, yeah. And that's what they did to the writers. And then they all kind of started dying.
Yeah.
And we thought that was pretty funny that they're all sitting there dying.
And the great thing, what we really lucked out, too, with the timing. I mean, we couldn't be more thankful to the WGA for the timing of the strike, because they basically, they went on strike the week that we were done with season 11. And the strike ended right about the time that season 12 started.
It's perfect.
And it was perfect for us because it never had to become an issue, you know, where they were coming to us and going, hey, you guys shouldn't work and you're not, you know, everyone just thought we were on strike too, which is pretty great. You know, it's like, oh, yeah, we're on strike too. whatever. But it's, you know, if they'd still been on strike and the season started, we'd be making shows. And between, this probably would have been the first one, actually.
Between this, SAG is about talking about striking right now. So, like, if there could be anybody dumber than WJ, it'll be SAG, of course. So we've been in, well, we've been in town for, what, 10 or 12 years? Yeah. And there's been two strikes. There's been the SAG strike and then this strike. And they are absolutely, they just don't work.
No.
There's just got to be a better way than, like, putting the whole town out of work, plus yourselves.
Yeah. But the great stories to come.
Yeah, the singles lines
yeah,
coming
God,
out of the
There's so many great stories
lines.
That came out. There was, like, there was singles day at the strike. And there was, like, the writers all made certain days of, like, you know, hey, it's bring a dog day to the strike line. They're trying to do all this stuff to get people to the picket line. And we heard too that it's like, you know, people are there with their cell phones and their mochaccinos
Starbucks
and stuff
cups.
Like that, and they're on singles day. I thought it's like, you guys, what are you doing? Come on.
Yeah, it just looked pathetic.
Yeah.
And it didn't work. And yeah. It didn't do anything. And it was just kind of sad.
It was really sad. And it's, you know, it was just that kind of thing of like no one would say. No one wanted to say that they completely got fucked over. And still to this day, of course, all the WGA people will say, oh, were you kidding? We got this, that, and the other. We did a great thing. The strike was amazing.
The DGA proved that they didn't have to go on strike.
Right, exactly.
So now we're going to have a bunch of writers hate us, and I don't care because I'll argue with all of them.
Yeah, fuck all y'all.
Yeah. All right. Was that enough? Did we get enough there? I'm trying to make them long enough. All right, next one.
Today's episode, I Fought Huckabees.
So this show was a few ideas put together. On the writers retreat. The writers retreat happened, I think, right after the Super Bowl, or
right after the Super Bowl.
Yeah, right after the Super Bowl. And so, you know, we were just talking a lot about. Oh no, the Super Bowl hadn't happened. That's right.
No, because remember, the Super Bowl hadn't happened. That's right. It was before the Super Bowl because
the Patriots were on their way to being 16-0, basically.
Right, and that's when everyone thought the Patriots are going to
win.
Yeah,
we're like, okay, they're going to win it all, so we've got to do something to kind of answer that because...
Take down Bill Belichick.
I'm a huge football fan. Matt's a football fan. And, like, we really felt like that whole thing that happened with the video cameras and whatever, that it really got swept under the rug. And no matter what anyone else says, you know, we heard everything. Everyone's like, oh, well, everybody does it. No, it wasn't as big a deal as they made it out to be. It's like, okay, but we always grew up learning that if you cheat, you know, there's consequences that matter. There's consequences that matter, and that if you cheat, you're a cheater. And but the NFL obviously really didn't want that image, and so they really tried to make it go away.
Yeah, you could tell the NFL closed ranks really quickly, and even what was kind of disturbing was the commentators on television. It was almost like the way some news stuff, it was like anybody who said, hey, you know what, I really think that that's wrong, they should lose the game, or, you know,
right.
Some like massive kind of thing should happen. They were just shouted down on by these commentators. Almost like the whole industry of football realized that the image of cheating in the NFL would hurt
all their jobs.
Which, you know, but it ended up having, for me, the opposite effect. You know, they should have kind of owned up to it and taken care of it, and then they would have been, like, appeared to be a lot better.
Yeah.
But anyway, it was just like... you know, the problem now with the Patriots is forever that era, they're cheaters. And Bill Belichick's a cheater, and they're all cheaters. And obviously, they didn't get there just by cheating and all that other besides, but that's what happens when you don't, like, lose that one game. You know what I mean? They lose that one game, you reverse that one game, but they can't do because of Vegas and betting.
Yeah.
Then all of a sudden, the whole thing makes sense. So anyway, we thought it was very important for us to take down Bill Belichick.
Well, and we thought at the writers, I remember at the writers retreat, we're like, well, this is only going to work if the Patriots win.
Right.
Because
if
they win, then we came up with this whole idea of doing stand and deliver, and we were going to actually
have it be.
And of course,
Cartman really looking up to Bill Belichick.
Right, right. But originally, remember, it was going to be a real, like, this Hispanic guy that shows up to teach the kids that was going to be a real parody of stand and deliver and how cheating. Do win, and that look at the Patriots. They cheated, and they cheated, and they won the Super Bowl. Nobody cares. As long as, you know, you win, no one cares if you cheat. And so, but then, of course, Patriots lost the Super Bowl.
Then, of course, God intervened.
Yeah, God made sure the Patriots
didn't. The fucking holy hand of God touched that game.
And then, so for a while, we're like, oh, it's too bad we can't do that idea now. But then we're like, well, no, because now we can just do the message that they gave up on cheating too soon. You know, like, if you're going to cheat, you got to cheat to the top. And that Belichick screwed his team because when it mattered most at the Super Bowl, he didn't cheat.
Yeah,
and so then we're like, okay, now this can be an idea that'll work well. And then, of course, but we always kind of felt like it was sort of a half of an idea. And then we had this other half of an idea, which was about Garrison finally. We've been wanting to turn Garrison back into a man again, just because we really want Garrison to go full circle. from, you know, a straight guy who hates gays to a gay guy to
a woman.
A woman who hates lesbians to a lesbian
right.
to a back to a man who now is going to, I don't know, hate.
Yeah, we grafted out. I think we got everything.
Yeah. But we had to, you know, we had to get a penis back, and that's right about the time that that little photo with the mouse with the ear on it came out on the internet, but which was fake apparently. But
we believed it.
It immediately, you know, the idea of a little penis running.
Well, we thought it was really like somebody sewed an ear on there. They grew an ear, but what they did was they took a ear-shaped thing of like plastic stump, something that like flesh could grow on. So it all just had the shape of an ear, and then they just made flesh grow on it like moss, and it would happen. So it was really kind of a bummer when we found that out. But in our episode, we just made it a real penis on a mouse.
Yeah,
and then the penis and mouse sing to each other.
Yep. We just photoshopped Eric Stiles' penis onto the mouse.
It was easy.
All right, that's cool.
All right, it's enough of that. Any adult teachers,
and since you handled your class so well, how'd you like to give it a shot?
So this is our no internet show, which was one of those ideas we'd had for a long time, I think.
Yeah.
An idea we had for a long time. In fact, I think we had a lot of the scenes of people just running around screaming that there was no internet for a long time before we really kind of figured out the rest of the show.
The Dust Bowl.
Yeah, once we figured out the Grapes of Wrath thing.
Yeah. Then it seemed to be kind of deeper and better. But we had the scenes of everyone running around and freaking out and going to Starbucks looking for a Wi-Fi. Spot. We had some of that stuff done before. I remember
just because it's so on every writer's retreat we have, you know, there's that if you ever, you know, in a hotel especially and there's no internet, it's like, it's just the
this actually happened to me a couple weeks ago where it was when we were still working where I like somehow, like I don't read the newspaper anymore because I just look at everything on the internet, and I was looking at a newspaper and there was a name I didn't recognize, and in my head I was like I can't click on the name. I was like trying to click on something newspaper. You know what I mean? You're so used to like, oh, I don't know what that is. And you click on it, you find out.
Link to it.
Yeah, I was trying to link to something in like the regular newspaper at a diner, and it didn't quite work. So it was like the whole thing of once you're kind of used to it, it now has become, for most of us, the internet is like, it's kind of like water. You know what I mean? It's like this thing we're just so used to, we can't live without.
This episode does definitely have, I think, the most offensive shot we've ever done in any South Park episode ever. And I cannot believe they let us
do it. With the slimed me?
Yeah. I actually cannot believe they let us put that on the air. And when I see it, it was one of those that, you know, when you're making a show, it's all just kind of, you know, you're just trying to get everything on you can. You're not really thinking it through. And this is one of those episodes that I saw a few weeks later and I was like, or, you know, or a few months later, and I was just like, oh, that's not cool. Like, I was really disappointed in the network.
I'm also glad we got to work in. I mean, that came out of the whole discussion about when we were in high school 4.5 million years ago. You know, you could get off by looking at a Playboy. And now I look at a Playboy now, and I'm like, it's like an old pinup doll from World War II, a pinup poster. It's just like, who could fucking get off on that?
Yeah, now we're used to seeing everything.
Japanese girls puke on each other. It's like, oh, yeah. So kind of, we got to work on that. That's good. It's like, I wonder, like, what 18-year-old kids, like, what is it going to morph into? Like, what kind of crazy shit are these kids going to need in 10 years?
My favorite, though, is putting in the Brazilian fart porn, because that, I think we first saw Brazilian fart porn about 2 years ago. It was circling around the office, and I don't know where you see. If you just type in Brazilian fart porn on your search engine, and you'll find it. It
now,
is the single goddamn funniest thing I've ever seen in my life. And I still can. It's one of those things I can watch like 1,000 times, like Devil's Advocate, and just laugh my ass off. It's just awesome. Go check it out right now. It's really awesome.
Also, this episode, what's the song? What's the song that Randy sings on the?
Oh, I'm going down the road for you.
So, after this episode came out, Jason McHugh, our friend and
old buddy from Cannibal.
He emailed me and said, you know, that's one of his, Jason's a big Deadhead and followed the Dead and went to a bunch of concerts. He said that that's one of, he said, oh, you guys did a Grateful Dead song. And I said, no, it's in Grapes of Wrath. And Trey really likes that song and liked that scene, so we put it in here. And then Jason told me that was Jerry Garcia's favorite movie. And that was his favorite scene, and that's why they played it.
Really?
So Trey Parker and Jerry Garcia have that in common.
Weak. I can't stand the Grateful Dead.
So I know Trey hates the Grateful Dead, so like, I thought that was pretty funny. I was like, well, at least Jerry has good taste on that shit, you know?
But we did that scene almost verbatim. That there is that scene in Grapes of Wrath, which I'm not a big Grapes of Wrath, the movie fan. I'm a big Steinbeck. I love Steinbeck, but I don't. The movie, I don't know.
Well, it's just, it's old. I mean, yeah, it's like watching an old 40s movie.
But I do like how people act and they talk all slow like. The whole movie, if it was shot today, would be like a half an hour long. Because everyone's
huge pauses between everything, long pauses. And that, you know, when they drive out west, it takes forever. They show every, it's like the old time, they just, here they come, over things. Follow the shot till they're totally out of frame.
And then it fades down. All right.
That's good. So this is super fun time. And this this episode, the idea of having a living museum and something actually have an original
and people that wouldn't break character.
And people who wouldn't break character while a blank is happening, we had for a couple of years and we could never quite
always smashing
break
our
it. Like, in fact, this was the original idea for the Katrina episode we did.
That's right.
Was there was going to be a flood. The boys were going to be at a pioneer village. No one would break character. There would be a big flood or something.
Right. But we just couldn't figure out what the boys are doing. Okay, they're in a flood.
And they're
what?
Trying to unflood the place. Like, what, you know, it's like not as... Then we finally, you know, we were doing this episode, we came up with the idea of a, you know, a diehard or, you know, bank robber terrorist kind of thing. And then the boys had something to get out of, and then it kind of all started happening. But we've had this idea of, like, these living museums, making fun of these living museums for a long time, because they're pretty funny. Yeah. We went to Plymouth Plantation one time, me and Trey, and watched them not break character there and get frustrated.
Yeah, it's really frustrating. I think everyone has been to a place like this. But, you know, I'll always remember season 12, because it was a pretty rough season. All in all the shows were pretty hard and kind of brutal. And but for some reason, both run, this run and then the second half of 12 season, both the last shows we figured out on Thursday and had like a super easy time.
Was this one of those?
This was one of those too, where we went in
and the
Thursday, we went in thinking, okay, we've got nothing and we're really tired and beat. And then we just, boom, you know, just came out and we sort of knew, once we kind of combined it with, okay, oh, it's a bank heist, and that's what the, you know, that's why they will break character. And then meanwhile, we've
you know
got
we had a different
time.
And we had a different episode with the Celebrity Sports Center idea. We kind of combined it a little bit. Because there used to be this place in Colorado when we were growing up called Celebrity Sports Center, which was just like, you know, when you're 10 years old in Colorado, it's like fucking heaven. Yeah. They have a water slide and like 5 arcade games and some shit like that. And so the idea was that the boys were going to go on a field trip, and then we had a different idea for sure. The boys were going to go on a field trip, and then they were going to escape.
Cartman and Butters were going to be pals that wouldn't, you know, and Butters wouldn't let go of his hand.
They were going to go to Celebrity Sports Center, so we kind of combined those two.
It kind of happens a lot, you know, where you've got ideas floating around that have never panned out, and then suddenly you realize, oh, put those two together, and it totally works.
Yeah.
And when that happens, it's really nice.
And then I remember the big thing, we died on this, and we tried to figure out the last thing of this episode to figure out, we figured on Tuesday late in the evening, was how to get Butters and Cartman back into the, when they're coming back in from Super Fun Time, the part where they shimmy across the thing, because they had to not, and they're hanging on the pole because they wouldn't let go hands. Remember that?
Yeah.
That was like this brutal,
very last,
and it was like this thing where it's like, all, as soon as we fucking figure this out, we can basically go home for 5 months.
Yeah.
And we couldn't figure it out.
We couldn't figure it out.
We were just dying on that stupid, like, how to get them back into there. God, Super Fun Time looks fun, too.
Well, because we also had...
There was a place called Funplex. Yeah, Funplex.
On Kipling. I think it's still... It's called something else now, but it was basically a Super Fun Time.
And it had a ballroom. It was new. It was a newer version of Celebrity Sports Center. It had a ballroom, those ball pits, the little plastic
with
balls.
The little plastic balls, yeah.
And lots of arcade games and race cars and shit.
And we like the idea. We're basically doing Die Hard, but that they had robbed a Burger King.
Well, that could be it for this first half.
So we'll go
first
to the second
half
of the season.
Let's go to the second half and get going on that. General Store. It's where I buy all my supplies
and such. So this was, now we're in the second half of the season, so basically these are the shows that came out October, November for the fall run. And, you know, the two big things that had happened basically over the summer were the big Summer Olympics games and the travesty of the Indiana Jones movie. and so we had come up with the idea, you know, we had come up with these ideas, but it's so funny because, you know, we kind of are victims of our own success in the sense that we... You know, we had this fun idea to do with Indiana Jones and with the Olympics, but we're like, yeah, but you know, that's already been like 3 months ago now. And people are, you know, it's like so passe now. It's like For any other show, it's really not passe.
It's so dumb that we think that.
Yeah, but it's
so
like
dumb.
It's really for us, you know, people are expecting us to comment on what happened the week before, not what happened 3 months ago.
Or we think they are.
Well, we think they are. Yeah. And some do. I mean, some, and sure, it's mostly the kids, you know, that are just basically like, oh, whatever, Indiana Jones, that came out 4 months ago. Why are they talking about that? You know. But it's like, well, come on, give us a little break.
The other thing is we wanted to talk about Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
You know, raping. The raping of Indiana Jones.
Yeah. It just was really... It was a travesty. But
don't get us started on Indiana Jones.
Yeah. But there were so many places we wanted to go with that idea. And, you know, really, probably this could have easily been two episodes. You know, a whole Indiana Jones show and a whole China Problem Olympic show. And one thing that happened, actually, was this doing this show, and you can totally tell if you listen, I was sicker than I've ever been trying to do a show. And so...
That's right. You had that really bad flu.
I actually lost my voice, remember? On Sunday, I had completely lost my voice. Matt had to do all of my lines. And then they had a doctor come in and give me a shot of steroids.
I'm surprised that shit worked. It was amazing.
Yeah, it was.
Like, Trey couldn't even talk, like, lose your voice talk. And then 2 hours later, it worked.
The doctor said,
just
he's like,
shot you with steroids.
I'm going to shoot you with this. And he's like, you're going to go to sleep for 2 hours. And I'm like, I can't sleep for 2 hours. It's Sunday. We got to get the show. He's like, listen to me. You're going to sleep for 2 hours. And when you get up, you're going to be fine. I'm like, there's no way. Because it was like the worst flu. I couldn't talk. And he shoots me the stuff. I pass out. I wake up and I go into Ann's office. And I'm like, I think I'm okay. And everyone's shocked that
why the fuck don't everyone give that all the time? What is that stuff?
But then he did warn me. And he said, you know, he's like, basically what we're doing is we're canceling your, like, you know, when you get flu and a cold, right, your body's trying to get rid of something. He's like, we're canceling that. So it's going to stay in. He's basically like, we're putting it on hold. And so now as I'm doing this, I'm super sick still because...
7 weeks later.
Yeah, 7 weeks later. Because
what I like about the raping parts, besides the fact that... what I like about the raping of Indiana Jones, these scenes... And this, again, it's kind of the Britney... It kind of reminds me of the Britney show. And it's very dark.
Yep.
And it's very much like, we're going to, you know, we're giving up some laughs for, like, intensity or whatever.
Yeah.
And what I like about it is that's... And if someone... If God help me if George Lucas came up to me and said, hey, that wasn't cool what you did that hurt my feelings or whatever. You know, I just have to sit there and watch. Like, in other words, like, we... That's what it felt like watching the Indiana Jones movie. It's like, there was a point, it was like, we were saying, is like, you're going to have to sit here and watch this raping in the same way you made us sit there and watch that.
Raping.
Like, we could cut away. Obviously, we can imply it and cut away and, like, you know, cut to the glass breaking and then you know what happened and we don't have to.
But then it wouldn't be what it was like to watch that movie.
We had to fucking sit there and watch that raping and we couldn't turn away and it, fuck you, and we're going to make you do the same thing.
And we were very aware, and in fact, when we were talking about the rape show being its own show, the sort of B storyline, which, you know, we didn't know how to do it as a story. We thought thematically it was a great point. Because really the scariest thing for us is watching this happen with Indiana Jones because we're like, we're going to end up doing that too. You
right.
know, we're not just like, Lucas and Spielberg, you suck. Because obviously they've given us some of the best things we've had in our life. And so, but the scary thing is watching that and going, wow, if they can be that good and then be that bad, is that just what happens when you get old?
Right. And that's so, an episode we almost should have done, but
yeah,
we didn't have faith in it.
You know, because then at the end, the boys were going to be like, you know, we're all going to get raped too someday.
So right now, so let's just preempt it. Right now, somebody's out there animating me and Trey raping the boys.
Yeah.
And so
We already thought of it.
We were going to do it too. And then we couldn't figure out a way to do it. Yeah. And then Trey got sick and we had to put the China program in there.
And we're not quite old enough yet. We still have a few years before we start raping the boys.
We might fondle and kiss and molest them.
Yeah,
but
we'll slowly,
rape, we're going to stop right before we rape.
Yeah.
I think we're, yeah.
I think it happens to everyone. All right.
All right, come on.
So this is Cartman versus Wendy, which we'd actually kind of come up with the season before. And, you know, it's just kind of like the new, one of the sort of newer directions the show goes sometimes where it's like, there's sometimes, you know, we really like to just do our version of Peanuts. And this is a really good example of that show where it's just all about the kids and it's all about the relationships of the kids and trying to, you know, put different kids together and see how they're going to react. And so...
It really was, it's the whole thing, like, when we first came up with the idea, the thing that we really liked was that position. I mean, Cartman's in it because he's Cartman, but it could be anybody. Is if you're going to fight a girl and you're in third grade, if you get beat up by a girl, you know, you're a douche and everyone hates you. But if you beat up a girl, you're a douche and everyone hates you. And so you're just kind of stuck. And to watch Cartman just get, It's always fun to watch Cartman especially get stuck and then try to get out and get himself deeper and get more stuck and not even realize, you know, what he's done to himself and stuff. So, like, that was the thing that we originally liked about this, was that kind of like, there's no way out, you know?
Yeah. And when we decided to put the breast cancer theme, I had just, my grandmother, who was awesome, died of breast cancer like a month before this. So I was like, let's put that in the show. That's funny.
Yeah. she'd be proud.
Yeah. I was trying to wear some awareness.
Yeah, that's right, killer titties. That's funny.
It is nice, you know, when we have a show that it's, and, you know, we obviously don't do it all the time. We try to make shows all kind of different, but it's nice when you have a show that's not got some big gigantic theme and it doesn't have this huge plot of like, all right, the boys go to space. You know, it's like, obviously, anytime you do that, you're kind of locked into explaining a lot of story. And so it's fun sometimes when we have these really simple stories and you can just let, you know, all the comedy come from the dialogue and the relationships between the kids.
Oh, yeah, and eating an underwear, that was a big breakthrough, too. That was like a big, like, when eating the underwear, I thought was really, really funny.
And then we almost cut it out.
Yeah, no,
it's so weird. You know what happens all the time with these shows, you know, because at first you sit there on Thursday and you're like, all right, well, Cartman and Wendy are going to fight and he's trying to get out of it. And it's like, well, that doesn't sound like, you know, a 21 minute. Like, how are we going to? Because sometimes, you know, a show can go all over the place. So at first you're sitting there going, well, we're going to have to think of something else because we'll never fill out the time. And then, of course, you always get there to Tuesday night and you're 2 minutes long.
Right.
And you can't figure out what to cut out, you know. So we always try to learn the lesson. We always say this at the end of the run. Well, you know what we really learned is keep the ideas simple because there's more room for the jokes. And just keep things simple. 21 minutes isn't a lot of time. And then for some reason, every season we start it and we're just like, oh, we need more. We need more. That's not enough of an idea.
It's we forget that our job is the right job.
Which is why China Problem and the Rape Show ended up being one show, because at the beginning of the run, we're like, okay, well, those ideas aren't big enough where they would have been.
Honestly, that we had this big discussion where we're like, well, that's not a big enough idea, the raping of Indiana Jones and the boys and us and the show and everything. No, that's not big enough.
And it's it wasn't at the time, but at something would have come out of it.
Yeah, but then the retrospect, we could have made a totally deep show out of that, but we just didn't have faith that. And then as we get later in the run, we simplify until...
Yep. See, that's already happened. We're getting older and we're starting to rape our own ideas.
Here it comes.
All right, let's move on.
Move on.
This is Pandemic, which is sort of another you're on the train or you're not. Only because, for a different reason, because, you know, for us anyway, there was like... We all thought it was funny, the idea of just these Peruvian flute bands, because they are all over the place. But then we kind of realized, like, well, we travel a lot. And afterwards it came out, you know, a lot of people were like, what are you talking about? A lot of people didn't really get it. And,
yeah. And
if you didn't get the whole Peruvian flute band thing and that they're taking over and they're everywhere, then obviously that's half the show, so you're not going to be...
Well, we had that idea... I mean, we didn't know exactly where it was going to go, but we had the idea of doing something about proving flute bands. And then we also came up with the idea, independently, of shooting live-action cute critters. Then we settled on guinea pigs. And then we found this place online where this lady made costumes for guinea pigs. And then we had this whole other idea about a live-action guinea pigs are taking over. And we were going to do something about... There was another idea. We were going to take the guinea pigs, and they were going to be... Before we combined these ideas, there was going to be a show where the guinea pigs would have... when the financial kind of meltdown started in September, October, it was like the guinea pigs were going to be... The government basically tried to... the government tried to help the economy, but they were going to basically inject some kind of steroid into the economy.
And to make it grow big.
To grow big, so they're testing on guinea pigs, and then they got big, and then they took over the bank, and they wouldn't let anybody in.
Yeah.
That might have been a good show.
Yeah.
But then we kind of were kind of sitting there, we've gotten halfway this proving flute band thing, and kind of like, well, this isn't... Need more of this. And then we found out guinea pigs are eaten in Peru and eat in kind of from Peru.
From the Andes Mountains in Peru.
And then we're like, well, fuck. And then they're kind of, we kind of have to put those together.
Yeah.
And so we kind of put them together.
And we were always trying to figure out a way to, we knew we wanted to do like this, you know, because the new way to do horror movies these days is like what we call startle. You know,
oh, yeah, and then the startle idea.
It's all just
yeah.
about like, psh, it's all just about trying to do 3 frames of something in a really loud sound to try to make people jump, even though it's,
It was that movie Quarantine that came out.
Yeah,
and I actually saw that thing, I think, before Indiana Jones, and I was just laughing because it was just so... It had no theme or string of any kind of logic.
It was trying to startle you.
It was just startling. That's not the same as being scared.
Yeah.
Being startled is not the same as being scared. Like,
And so we knew we wanted to do, you know, something with that, with the guinea pigs, but we couldn't figure, it's like, okay, but how do we shoot it? And then we're like, of course, it's someone got a video camera, because then you're doing the whole Cloverfield thing too.
And then people, yeah. And so that was a big breakthrough, getting Randy to get a new video camera.
Yeah, that actually came like probably, what, Monday night? Like,
I was going to say Saturday, because they did all those big shots in like 2 or 3 days, yeah.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
Saturday night, maybe.
Sunday, probably Sunday. Then.
Yeah. All these big, on this episode, the couple of big shots. I mean, these handheld shots are pretty technically challenging for
yeah, and
the
so,
crew.
I mean, the way that we kind of figured out how can we do this quickly was, since, you know, so much with a handheld camera is you're whipping around and you're whipping to something else. So we basically cheated it where the camera's on something and you're seeing a guinea pig and then it starts to whip. And then we just cut in a bunch of whipping and then we whip onto the next scene. So rather than being one long shot with a real whip across real stuff, it's all kind of faked like that. And that's what made it possible to do.
And Cloverfield could have been a good movie. It wasn't very good, but it could have been good. And one of the main things about Cloverfield, it could have been good if it was rated R, basically.
Right.
If it could have been just hardcore.
Yeah.
So you notice that people in Cloverfield say, oh my God.
Yeah.
Because they can't say fuck,
right.
Which is what you would do if something was happening like
right.
that. They just scream, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And so that's, again, Randy, like, just screams, oh my God, all the time.
Yeah. And we do like taking shows, you know, like we did with Clyde and the Lice episode, you know, we like taking characters we've seen for a while and you know, let them be in a show and learn a little bit more about them. And that was the fun part with Craig here, because I love Craig's little attitude throughout this entire thing.
Yeah, Craig gets his little, like, this is what always happens with you guys.
Yeah.
That's why Craig just knows if he goes and hangs out with them, he's going to end up in space.
And the best thing, we really lucked out. The band that did all this Peruvian flute music lived in L.A. And was actually like, Anne got a hold of the guy and is like, not only could we get the stuff, but we were able to say, okay, can you play Mary Had a Little Lamb for us? And can you play? And then my favorite thing was at the end of part two, we had them play Cars by Gary Numan. And I actually think the Peruvian flute band version of Cars is one of my favorite pieces of music I've ever heard.
Well, let's move on to part two.
Go to part two, and we'll talk more about guinea pigs.
You see, Craig? So this is part two of Pandemic, and it is like the idea of the basic. I mean, part of the idea this idea started too with the making fun of that movie Night of the Lepus, or those big creature movies of the 70s where they would just, you know, make a little town and have grasshoppers or ants go through it, and then they would, you know, the big, I don't know what they call it, big animal movies or something. There's an ants one, and there's one with a lot of critters. There was one with rats. But then when we came to the idea of base, so then the idea is kind of morphed into this thing of where we could dress them up in little costumes, right? And then we looked online, and then there was somebody who made costumes for guinea pigs.
Yeah, all these costumes were not made by us. We found a website and a woman who made these, and we're like, oh, there's a little dinosaur, there's a little prison outfit, and we're like.
So that's how the jokes came from what was available, not so much like the pirate was just because there was pirate.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, was there anything we didn't use? There was a couple we didn't use.
Yeah,
there was a leprechaun.
Yeah, other human things, like a fireman, remember?
There's
like
a fireman.
But, you know, the thing was is that when we first had the idea, we're like, all right, well, let's just get guinea pigs in costumes and we'll just shoot a bunch of stuff of them, you know, eating and running around and doing all this. And then, so we actually, you know, set up a whole shoot and had a big green screen and had a crew there. And we got these guinea pigs and we got these costumes. And if you put a guinea pigs don't move around much anyway. But if you put a guinea pig into a costume, their defense mechanism is to freeze.
Yeah, it's like a playing dead thing.
Yeah.
It's like a possum thing. They do not move.
And so as soon as they get put into a costume, they think they're about to die, and they just will not move at all.
In fact, some of the shots would look like freeze frames. We're like, okay, we'll play it. And they're like, it is playing. And it was just this thing would just sit there and not move and not blink and not Twitter and not anything.
Yeah.
It would just sit there. So all the footage you see of all the little bit of movement in all this show is like there'd be 180 minutes of footage and you're seeing like the 16 seconds where they're moving.
There are 3 full days of shooting, and out of those 3 full days came the shots that are in the show where they're at least twitch a nose or blink or do something in the costume. And then, you know, in the week before, you know, for last week's episode, we were able to get them walking across because they weren't in costume. But as soon as we put them in costume, it was just trouble. I think we finally got a couple of them to take like a couple steps. And then, you know, that's why then the whole idea, once we had shot the guinea pigs, we're like, okay, they do absolutely nothing. We're like, well, then that's the joke, is that the camera's moving around, people are screaming, but they're really just sitting there doing absolutely nothing.
Which kind of goes along with Startle, too.
Yeah.
I barely made it back to the house.
My favorite part of this episode is when they're stuck in the bus, Randy, Randy's like, I'll check outside, and he goes in, and then he looks down to the steps, and he goes, when he goes down the steps. Like, the idea of Randy's making this more dramatic and more scary is really funny.
Yeah, really nothing much is happening. But yeah, these are, I mean, basically just your typical sort of green screen shots with real guinea pigs. I don't know why a dude falls out that window. It doesn't make any sense.
Look at that thing. Well, you're not doing anything.
Yeah. Randy, what are we gonna do?
And here's one. Of course, we didn't actually have it bust through. We just had to have it, like, be there because it doesn't do anything.
Oh, that was moved a little bit. He actually turned and looked.
That was probably an hour it took to get that thing to do that.
Yeah.
Michaels, Harrison, anybody? Yep. Is that it?
That's really it. Yeah.
That's all.
Let's move on.
LSAT is down and no answer at RCU. Whatever's going on out there, it's huge.
So, yeah, here's the big election show. And this is the true story, what happened with this. We, during the writer's retreat, we had an idea. We realized that, oh, we're going to have a show air the day after the election. So we're going to have to do a... And it actually worked out really great, because as we were getting closer to the election, people couldn't believe we weren't talking about Obama and Palin and McCain and all this. And so, and it got to be like 2 weeks before, and we were doing... Guinea pigs costumes, and people are like, what are you doing?
There was a second when we thought about making Pandemic 2.
All About Obama.
All About Obama was like, yeah, and then we thought about that, and then we just said, no, we're not going to. And I think that's what perplexed, you know, people even more, is like, why the fuck am I watching guinea pigs the week before this huge election?
Because they were all sure that, you know, it's like, well, that was your last chance. You know, you know, the week before the election, you could have done a big show. But we had already knew at the writer's retreat, we're like, all right, we're going to air an episode on Wednesday after the election. We all know we're going to be up all night Tuesday anyway, fixing, you know, doing all the last-minute changes to the shows we always do. So why don't we just do it? We'll air it on Wednesday, and we can put stuff in from the actual election. And so as we're talking about it, we're like, well, what do we do? Do we make two? And it's like, yeah, we'll make two. You know, we'll make a version where McCain wins and a version where Obama wins.
And this was in August.
August. And, of course, you know, being the lazy bastards that we are, as it got closer to the run, we only had one version, which was all the stuff with Obama winning. And we're like, well, what are we going to do? We can't risk it. But then we were just so... We're like, Obama's going
to win. As it got closer to the election, it was pretty obvious he was going to win.
And it's like, there's just no way. And so we didn't spend any time doing a McCain version. We wouldn't have had time. And so, and I remember there was
about 20 minutes, like 10 minutes or 20 minutes, like 8 o'clock or 7 o'clock, whatever. And I was like, oh man.
When McCain won those first few states, you know, he was really far ahead at first because they did, you know, certain states first. And there was definitely this, like, we were sitting there going, if he wins, we are just literally fucked. Like, what do? Like, we just have this whole Obama show. And we were like, and there's no way to change it because all this stuff with the, you know, I mean, the storylines were even, they wouldn't make any sense if you switched them because, you know, the people are out partying because it's Obama and, you know, you couldn't.
It just wouldn't make any sense.
It wouldn't make any sense. So we were just talking about what do we do, and we were basically going to do this. We were
If McCain did pull it out
somehow. If McCain had won, we were going to just show the show, but we were going to do commentary over it and say, and be explaining, okay, well, we really thought Obama was going to win, so this would have been sweet, but you kind of screwed us, America. And
you so know, you have to see a shitty show.
Yeah.
Basically, you fucked up America.
Luckily, Obama pulled it out. And then, you know, we were able to sit there and watch the acceptance speech, and we just had everyone, we were ready for it, so we kind of had everyone standing by as Obama gave a speech and writing it down as he was talking. And of course, it's great with the internet because 10 seconds after he gave the speech, it was online, you know, to down, you know. And
we were just trying to figure out what line, then you could see, like, what lines by 4 or 5 in the morning, West Coast time. What lines the press was like, oh, this is the big line.
But remember, I wrote the one in because
We
did a temp version, and I took his speech, and I'm like, okay, what's... And it's all just such typical...
No, before he did his speech. This is like the day before.
Oh, no, that's what I was going to talk about, the dog thing.
Oh, yeah, the dog thing.
Because the thing was, like, his whole speech was such typical political fodder that anyone would say. But there was one point where he said, you know, we're going to... There's something about the fact that
the kids
get a puppy because we're going to the White House. And I'm like, people are going to remember that. So I wrote that line, and sure enough, that's the thing that I remembered.
What I was talking about was like a couple days before, you wrote just some temp stuff to put in there. So we kind of, it'll be about this long, and it'll kind of like, kind of went in. change. And it was seriously almost exactly Obama's speech anyway. Just like you can, like, those political speeches at that level, you basically know what they're going to say.
You know exactly what they're going to say.
That crappy boilerplate, you know, stuff. But I thought you did a very good job with the speech, but very good job sounding like Obama.
And so this week was a lot of, you know, a lot of times when we're parroting something, there's a lot of time spent sitting there watching the movies you're parroting. So this was my big week of watching all the Ocean's movies, which I had never seen before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'd seen Ocean's 11, which is which is fine. It's
Ocean's 11 was fine. Yeah. The other two are ridiculously bad.
But. Yeah, but Ocean's 11 is a fun movie to watch, even though it's kind of dumb. But it was also the big, it gave us the attitude of basically Obama and McCain are Clooney and Pitt. Right. That they're thieves, but they're great guys. And they don't kill people, and they kind of rip off things that, you know, they're not ripping off poor people. Or, you know what I mean? They're not
bad. Which was a great change.
They're likable thieves.
Yeah. Originally, actually.
We had an idea that they were like more like.
They were way more hardcore.
Like cliffhanger.
They were like shooting people. And
we had cliffhanger villains, like John Lithgow and Cliffhanger.
They were really bad guys. They were bad thieves. But then, and actually what had changed it was the fact that we had done Pandemic, and we're like, wow, we just did this big government conspiracy thing where the guy was like, man, shooting people. And we're like, we're going to do this again. Like, I guess we can't do it. And then we thought, well, let's make them like the Ocean's 11 thieves. And then it actually made it a lot better, I think.
Yeah, it made it better,
good,
too.
Good change. Hey, you guys wanna buy a TV? Change you can believe in.
That's good change. Let's move on.
Elementary School Musical. This was one of those ideas out of nowhere. This was a Thursday out of nowhere idea.
And we I don't remember where it came from talking about. I don't remember.
I think High School Musical 3 had just opened.
It came from just watching. Yeah, and then the idea of just like everyone singing and the boys don't know why. And right?
But it was
the first idea. What was
I remember someone just saying, you know, because we're like, okay, well, what's going on? What's going on? You know, our typical Thursday thing. And someone said something about High School Musical 3. And you know, we had talked about High School Musical before just because obviously it's big with kids this age, so it comes up. But we, you know, and then I was like, and I said jokingly, like, oh, yeah, let's do a High School Musical. And all I have to do this week is write a whole freaking musical. And, like 20 minutes later after talking about it, we're like, oh wait, that's a pretty good idea. I guess we are doing this. And but then it was good because I realized pretty quickly that it wasn't a musical in the way that like the South Park musical, the movie was, because it was a parody, and the songs in High School Musicals suck ass. And they're super, you know, they don't
make any sense.
Yeah, they don't need to be, the songs
don't
shouldn't
need to
be funny.
Right.
Writing funny songs is hard, but writing, you know, just fodder songs, that can be done in a week. And so it was it was really just writing, you know, watch it. So now, of course, after
the week before, the songs are like storyless. There's no, that's what made it work.
And it just has, random lines in it. But whereas the week before we were watching a lot of Ocean's movies, now all of a sudden we're watching all the High School Musical movies, which was way more brutal than watching all the Ocean's movies. But
these, you know, the other thing is like with kids, our kids are 8 or 9 years old. It's like that is the High School Musical age, I think. We're 8 or 9 year old kids in America, they all know High School Musical, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I think.
Yeah.
And, you know, fourth grade kids, the stuff they watch is them in high, is they think about high school. And high school kids watch Melrose Place because they think they're, you know, it's like you're always watching above
people
your
people in 20s want to watch shows with people in their 30s. Matt and I like watching people in their 70s now.
we're just getting ready.
We just go back and watch Cocoon over and over again.
The bucket list. That's a bucket list.
But you know, it was when we had come up with the idea with the Bradley, this little, or no, what's his name? Bryden, and his father, who you know, is the abusive dad, but abusive in that he goes around slapping people all the time. That's the part I really like.
The slap party.
Yeah. And I don't know why there's a pig nose on that girl, but that was obviously, I mean, this is a parody of the scene in High School Musical 1 where they're in the cafeteria and there just is this part where this fat girl's dancing on a table and someone put a pig nose on her.
Yeah, I think that's not very cool. I can't believe they did that. This episode's written a little bit different. I mean, this is kind of writer geek talk, but there's a lot of stuff in this episode where it's a little bit different, especially towards the end, where we don't see, I don't know what you would call this, but we don't see characters make decisions as much as set them up, and then the next scene you see them and they've made the decision.
Right.
So the boys in the end, you don't see them working on their song or anything, but you know they have.
Right.
Or you don't know they have, and it's revealed in the last scene. Oh, that's, you know what I mean? Or so you set them up and then you pay them off in the next scene. So I don't know what kind of
It's probably good writing.
It's probably good writing.
Other than the shitty stuff we do where it's like we try to explain every single thing.
Well, we did it in the Vampire show, the next show a little bit too. Maybe it's better.
I think it's better.
Maybe it's the rebirth of South Park right now. South Park 3.0.
There's going to be more shows like this. Or maybe actually it's probably worse because we're getting older. It's that rape thing. I think we're probably just getting stupid.
Maybe this is we're molesting our kids right now. Cool. Let's see what the next one, how we molest them next.
Today we're going to discuss the Berlin Wall.
So this, the Ungroundable was another sort of gift from God at the end of a tough run because what had actually happened was that in the room when we were kind of figuring out, okay, what should the end of the of High School Musical episode be? We were like, oh, how about, you know, the girls just suddenly are on to the next thing? And I'm like, well, what is it? Because the movie that was coming out was that
Twilight.
And we're like, oh, okay, so that's the thing, is that the boys show up, they do their big song, but the girls aren't into High School Musical anymore. Now they're into Twilight, and they're all dressing up like vampires. And we were like, yeah, and that seemed like a great idea, but then we're like, wait a minute, that could actually be its own show. And
it was coming up with the goth kids.
Yeah, and
making
so,
a goth kid story.
Like, how would... Yeah, because... And then it was
like a whole
oh, yeah,
show.
There's this... Yeah, and it was going to be the end of last week's episode, and we're like, oh, yeah, and then the girls are all dressing like vampires, and then we can have the goth kids show up at the very end and be like... And then we're like, wait a minute, that's a big emotional thing for goth kids to, when, you know, kids
like people co-opting their
style. It's suddenly cool the way they're dressing. And so we're like, all right, well, let's hold on to that. We'll save it. And then Thursday we came in and sort of started talking about a vampire episode and came up with the whole Butters storyline of him wanting to be one and thinking they were real and all that stuff. And so it was another show where we kind of just out of nowhere kind of figured it all out on Thursday, which was a blessing.
Yeah. We talked a lot about how goth, because like when we grew up, there was probably a vampire craze at some point. I don't know. But goth kids, that was a big thing, you know, if you were into The Cure and Sisters of Mercy and shit like that. And you dressed all in black and you were depressed and you smoked and you hang out at the Denny's. And like that was definitely, even though Trey and I didn't go to high school together, we both had that group in our high schools. Like it seems like a pretty common clique that, you know. And then vampires, it seems like a very different thing. We're trying to talk about like where the line is between vampires and goths and why the goths are like, no, we're not like that. Like, this isn't, we're not playing around. We actually are depressed.
Yeah.
Right? And we actually are bummed out and we actually like to drink coffee
right.
and smoke.
This isn't fun.
I wish I didn't have to be this way.
Actually, I didn't tell you this, but I was in Nashville last weekend to go to a Titans game just for the fun of it. And we ended up on Saturday night at this random bar in Nashville where there was like, there's these, what'd they call themselves? They were like skinheads against racism or something like that. So they were skinheads and they had like skinhead, but it was just like, but all their tattoos said things like equality and, you know, racial, you know, acceptance and all this stuff. And it was like, what? And, but anyway, what, they were hanging out with all these other people. And this one girl who had like all these studs pierced in her upper lip and then all these studs pierced in her forehead and tatted all over and black. She comes up to me and she goes, thank you so much for that vampire episode. And it was just like, you know, it was like finally speaking for us, you know, and those freaking, it was like totally, she was totally the goth girl just going, oh, thank you so much.
But it made me, we kind of realized doing this episode that we like the goth kids, that they're kind of cool, yeah. You know, that like they have their little like depressing attitude, but that essentially they're kind of cool. They're kind of cool people.
Yeah. I really like the goth kids. I mean, I liked it, and I went back and watched that episode where we first came up with them, the Raisins episode, and we were definitely, like, ripping on them in that episode and sort of saying the same things about them, like they were just playing this part.
They're conforming to their own thing. And, they, right.
And we were ripping on them, but, you know, they've made little appearances here and there since then, and then, you know, I think this show is the final kind of, like, them really coming to be as their own character. I think we'll see more of them just because I really like them.
Yeah, I like them, too. They're kind of this other... There's this other attitude in the school that's not really represented.
Yeah. And I like to, you know, the way we've used them in the past is they're kind of Stan's little subconscious. Like, he's kind of sometimes who they talk to him and he talks to them when he's having problems emotionally. And that's the way I really want to keep using them. I think
it's like one of the, yeah, the, in that way we talked about. And what they don't like about this is they like being invisible. They like being out by the dock and smoking. And this kind of pulls them into the line, you know, this pulls them into the. Into the school's life, and they don't want to be a part of it.
Right.
And they get confused with these vampires and stuff. So I like the goth kids.
Yeah. So that all being said,
maybe we'll molest them next year.
I think what we'll do, I think now I'm really excited to make a whole nother year of South Park so that we can do commentary on them right about this time next year.
So wait, you're saying next year after Thanksgiving, we get to come back here and do
commentary? 1 year from today, we can be right here doing this again.
Fuck yes.
But everyone, thanks for watching, and we'll try to make some more and make them funny.
Bye-bye.
Thanks.